Quick discussion. There's not too much that I have to say over here. Primary reason being that it's still in a proposal kind of stage. We don't have a direct tax law. There's no law that is going to be effective 1st April 2011. We have a first draft of the direct tax code, and we have some revisions that they have proposed. The actual bill is still going to be introduced in the monsoon session of the parliament, and by the time it finally comes into being, we'll probably see a lot of amendments on the way. However, there's some anxiety about this, so I thought we'll get this behind us. The stage, and I'll be discussing only things which affect us as investors. I'm not getting into corporate tax kind of issues over here. So nothing, no discussion on MAT, etc. What has happened between the first draft and the second draft is, earlier there was a proposal that when you put money into a savings scheme, things like provident fund or life insurance policies or all of these pension plans, etc., that much deduction will be given to you. All the returns that accumulate on that would be exempt. So exempt, and finally when you withdraw money from these schemes, it was to be subject to tax. Pure life insurance policies, which is life insurance policies not in the nature of investment products, and annuity schemes. These items will be exempt even at the time of withdrawal. That is as it stands today. What is a pure life insurance contract? No one knows. All these definitions, fine prints still have to come out. Earlier draft spoke about exempt taxable regime. We don't have any clarity on what happens to that. One thing that they've mentioned is it will be a prospective change. So whatever balance you have accumulated as on 31st March 2011, that will not be subject to tax. Any growth over that will be subject to tax when you finally withdraw. So anything which is tax-free under the current tax laws up to 31st March 2011, this is I am talking about a small savings kind of instruments. If you have equity-linked savings scheme under the mutual fund regulations, if you have that, the NAV as on 31st March 2011, that will not be taxed. Another thing which is concerning a lot of people is what happens to the capital gain tax, what happens to the existing assets that we own. The first draft was very scary. The first draft did away with distinction between short term and long term capital gains. So under that, we would end up paying 30% tax on all the capital gains that we would have made. What they have done is, in the revision, they have spoken about bringing back the distinction between short term and long term. Short term gains will be subject to tax as per your tax rate. So for most people it would be around 30%. Long term gains, they have spoken about giving a deduction on your long term capital gains. Again, they have not specified a rate. They have given examples. I don't know what sense it makes giving examples, but they have given examples ranging from 50% deduction to 70% deduction. Effectively, the examples that they have given mean a effective tax rate of between 9% and 15% on long-term capital gains for equity shares listed and for equity oriented mutual fund units. This does not cover unlisted equity shares. It also does not cover debt mutual funds. So all those are out.
Real estate?
Not even real estate. Only two asset classes, equity shares and equity oriented mutual funds. Those will be subject to a tax rate, effective tax rate of around 9 to 15% if we go by their examples this is not the final rate. Final rate could be anything. They have not even proposed the final rate so far. Interestingly, they have also put a statement for existing equity share investments. Appropriate transition regime will be provided if required. What is appropriate? What is the transition regime? And what is if required? Obviously, it is required. Anybody who is sitting on capital gains tax today requires a transition regime. So, what is the meaning of this sentence? I am not clear at all. A simple question that most people have today is, if you are having equity shares today, the market value of which is 200 rupees, your purchase price is 100 rupees and purchased maybe 2, 3, 4 years back, what happens to this gain? Is there any clarity today? There is no clarity. All we have is appropriate transition regime will be provided if required. So if you want to rely on this, you can continue holding on to your equity shares, and worst case scenario, you could end up paying around 9% or 15% capital gains tax in the future years. If you want to play it safe, book that gain right now. Again, buy back the same asset if you want. You lock into the current market rate as your cost. All your older capital gains become tax free. These are the two options that you have. You will end up paying brokerage, impact cost, STT, all of these. So it's a personal choice to make. One recommendation I have, since you have waited for so long, wait for another 15 days or a month, by which time the bill could be introduced in the parliament. Let's see what shape the bill comes in, then one can decide what is to be done. All other assets like real estate, like debt mutual funds or any other assets that you have, two things are going to happen. One is, if it's a very old asset, if it's an asset which was purchased, let's say 30, 40 years back, you don't have to consider the original cost. The cost will be of the year 2000. So your cost base goes up. And further, you get indexation benefits in line with the inflation index. So your indexed cost of acquisition has to be reduced from your sale price. That will be the capital gains, which will be taxed at the full tax rate of 30% or whatever is applicable to the taxpayer. So this is the direct tax code as I have understood it as on date. I am not a tax practitioner, so best thing is to consult someone who's practicing it on a continuous basis for more information on this. Any simple questions that you have, I can take them. Any difficult questions, you can ask Sudit bhai when we break for. So
I have a question on the EET. If it is exempt while you invest it, exempt when you get returns on it. But suppose you, if it's a mutual fund or whatever, it's a growth option. Whatever dividend or whatever interest you are earning from it before its maturity, you reinvest it back. At the time of maturity, in other words, those, that dividend, that interest has again been taxed, right? Which was,
if you look at the kind of things that are there, these are not the kind of instruments which pay you out anything. These are the retirement products mainly. You have your recognized provident fund, which is a company provident fund for employees. You have public provident fund. You have pension plans and your life insurance contracts. So these are not products which pay you out anything, or there is no reinvestment kind of mechanism here. Here either you opt for a pension at the end of retirement, or you have death benefits coming, or whole life benefit coming on life insurance policies. So the question that you have, equity mutual funds are not covered, debt mutual funds are not covered here.
That's what I'm asking.
Those will come under the capital gains kind of structure.
So what is the second E for?